Happy Sabbath. I trust everybody a week. But it's over now. Let's have a word of prayer. Let me get started. Heavenly Father, again, we have the opportunity, privilege, and great honor to come and worship before you on the Sabbath. And may our worship be acceptable to you, Father. May we keep your Sabbath holy. We praise you, Lord, and thank you for your sacrifice that you made in your Son. May we take full advantage of that in your Spirit. We ask and pray your presence here this day. In Jesus' name, amen. We are to guard that gift jealously, but we so quickly give it up to other people. Anyhow, folks, I want to continue on with what we were looking at. Let's go back to Ephesians and look at what we were talking about last week. Now, keep in mind, we were looking at Revelation 3, some of Mrs. White's commentary on our relationship to the world. And in the light of strengthening what remains, and of course, this also deals with the Laodicean condition, rich, increased with goods, etc., etc. We looked at the situation between David and Nabal, and Luke 12, and we're going to go back to that. The man who was so wealthy and increased with goods that he decided to do what? I got it in my mind, and this is just my way of thinking. I don't know if there was, and I haven't read the background on it. I have, but not to the extent of whether or not this was actually a thing that happened. Known in the region that Jesus was commenting on, because many of the things that he did happen. And it was kind of like headlines out of the newspaper that he was commenting on, like the fall of the tower and this and that. But anyhow, I can't help but think that Jesus wasn't drawing from the situation with Nabal when he spoke of this man. He had said in his mind, what did he say? What did he say? What did this wealthy farmer say? I'm rich and increased with goods, and I can take my ease. I have plenty to eat and drink. And the Lord said to him, you fool. Don't you know that your soul is required of you? How would you translate that? Well, not just that you're going to die, but you've made your choice, and it's going to be sealed because I'm taking back the breath of life. You no longer have an opportunity to repent. Isn't that interesting? So when he said, you fool, your soul is required of you, the very evening, after he made that decision, he said, you make a fire. Because instead, yeah, Rita?
This man was pretty much in the Laodicean condition.
Yes, he
thought
was.
Everything was good. He was fat and happy. And that was the end of it for him because his probation closed if his soul was required of him.
Mm-hmm.
But in the Laodicean message, there is still hope for the church because this is a warning from Jesus. This is your condition. This is your situation. And if you don't change, this is what will happen to you. So Laodiceans still had the opportunity to redeem them, to correct themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And the man has had this admonition. And you can change that whole scenario and just take man out of there and put, how about church? Do you think Jesus was just referring to one individual? Not reflection of the current events of what was going on in the first century Seventh-day Adventist church? This man's situation? Isn't this the attitude of the ruling class? Oh, we don't need you. We have our positions. We have our money. We're set. All we want from you is to give us bigger barns. That's what they wanted from Jesus, isn't it? What would the bigger barns, you think, be? Control over the Romans, you see? So you can apply that to a corporate spiritual situation. But Jesus said to them when he wept over Jerusalem, you fools, don't you know your soul is required of you this very evening? You can apply it there. It was the end of it. Because in Matthew 23, the only place in the Bible that the temple was referred to as your house. Because prior to all of that, even going all the way back to the tabernacle, where did it ever say that it was not God's house? So when Jesus said, your house is left unto you desolate and walked out, what did that mean? You fool. You fools. Your soul is required of you right now. That was it. The hatchet came down. That was the close of their probation right there. People, the stoning of Stephen, yes. However, for that system, when he walked out and he said, your house is left unto you empty, that was it. What more was there to say? It was over. The fight's done. So it was the same thing. They were, which brought us to Ephesians 5, where Paul, when we read this last week, and I'm going to read through these verses again just to set the pace because I want to move forward from there because this is very interesting. 22 down to 33, it says, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject to Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ so loved the church and gave himself for it. Very important to qualify all these statements, and we did last week. That doesn't mean that husbands lord over the wife. Is that what Jesus does with the church? Does he lord over the church, or does he require respect out of love and respect? How did Jesus gain the respect of the church, by the way? How did God redeem, reclaim the church? So husbands, when you want to be ruling lords, are you prepared to die? That he might sanctify and cleanse it, verse 26, with the washing of water by the word. Very significant. That he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but it should be holy and without blemish. What does holy mean? What is the translation of the word holy? Separate. Consecrated, separate for service for the Lord. So then, should we be listening to men or to Jesus? Interesting. Now, you'll notice the transition here that Paul made. The marriage situation is a small habitat, if you will, of a heavenly situation. It's supposed to be heaven on earth, but that's not what the devil's done with it, Kody.
That reminds me of just how we think as individuals. How they were thinking back then is the same way we're thinking now. Mm-hmm. We always focus on the institution. Mm-hmm. We want Jesus to come and build up the institution. You know, even now in the secular world, people look to the government. They want the government to solve all the problems. You know, and we're always looking to these buildings, and we think that if we stay within, even Seventh-day Adventists, they think if they stay in the conference, then they're saved mm-hmm. automatically.
That's right.
And Jesus does deal with things on a corporate level, but he always deals with it on an individual level too. So we have, if we want to be saved, if we don't want to have our soul required of us and have our probation end, we need to be focused on him.
That's right.
And following him. He's our shepherd, not any man or person or building or program. The church is always focused on the, oh, we're going to come out with this new program and it's going to be great mm-hmm. and everything. And everybody's all focused on that rather than doing their own Bible study and focusing on their yep. own salvation.
Yep, that's right. And Bible study is fine, but he wants us to do the work. Because you can have, Peter says, people study the scriptures to their own destruction. I know many say, well, that means they twist them. It also means that they don't do anything with them. I mean, Peter lived in a society that was what was going on, wasn't it? They knew the scriptures better than anybody else. But what did Jesus say about them? They're whitewashed sepulchers full of dead bones. Paul knew the scriptures better than most people on the planet. He was probably one of the top five at the time. What was he doing? He was killing Christ's followers.
You have to put into practice what you learned.
Sure.
Jesus even said, do as they do, or do... I lost what that was. Don't do as they do.
Do as they say, not as they do.
Right, exactly.
They are taught well, but they don't do what they practice, what they preach. That's what they hated Jesus for, because he practiced what he preached. He practiced, then he preached. He told why. Yeah, Kody.
And just another thing, kind of caveat off of that whole, everything you guys are saying there, it's like what Isaiah says. I think in like the 26th chapter, I'm not exactly sure. It's around there, mm-hmm. where it's like you have been told that the book is sealed, or that you don't have that right education, so you don't understand the Bible. So that's what we're being taught today too, yep. that these people are modern Pharisees come up and they say, oh, you don't know the Bible, you haven't studied it long enough like me, and you don't understand all these things, so you can never understand salvation.
That's right.
So you should listen to me.
That's right. Now, I want to ask you another question. From verse 22 to verse 25, what do you see in there? Other than, you know, it says wives do this, husbands do that. But what is the main theme of what Paul is saying they're doing as far as each other's concerned? Sacrifice. Putting the other first. Do you notice that? It's give and take. More give. So what is being said here, our relationship to Christ, and remember we talked last week about being the bride. So we're talking Jesus, the Holy Spirit through Paul is defining a marriage here. And remember, what is the church? The bride. Who is the bridegroom? Who arranges the marriage, by the way? The Father. He picks the bride all through the Bible. Who picked the wives of the faithful Seventh-day Adventists? The Holy Spirit sent this one there, that one there. Abraham, did he pick his own wife? Isaac, Jacob? Well, Abraham may have, because I don't know. He was married when he came out of Ur of the Chaldees. But don't you think that the Holy Spirit didn't have a hand in directing that marriage too? Because even there, they were arranged marriages. It wasn't go to the bar, find some woman, and vice versa, and get married, and then fight and kill each other, have a bunch of kids, and get divorced. That's how Rome does it. See, that's the Roman Catholic bride and bridegroom, you see. So, and then he says here in verse 26, the reason for this sacrifice is this. Whether it's a secular marriage, and Paul is changing the whole atmosphere of this to the bride and the bridegroom that the Father picks for his Son. He says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. What does the washing of water mean? What is that referring to? Now, in the temple, you had a laver, correct? There was washing that took place. What is baptism? But you'll notice it's a washing of water by what? Not by ceremony, by the Spirit's sword, we could say. The Word. Don't listen to what men tell you about your marriage because it's of no value. The only way you'll have a sanctified, cleansed marriage is how you interact with whom? The bridegroom. And you know what? Who has the responsibility now for the wife? According to what I just read. Who has the total responsibility for how that family turns out? It's the husband. He's going to pay the heavy price. Heavier. So these husbands that want to be these overlords, better be careful what you're doing. Rita?
In John 17:17, it says, sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. That's how you do it.
There you go. Not what Kody was talking about, the organization, the this, the that. Jesus and Paul, Saul, when he was of Tarsus, were dealing with organizations, weren't they? Wasn't it all about organization? This man that wrote this was a staunch enemy of Jesus Christ. Do you realize that? Whether it was by choice or not really realizing it, he did not know who Jesus Christ was when he was working for the Sanhedrin. He was the enemy, because Jesus even said, why do you persecute me? Isn't that what he said to him? There was great enmity between him and Christ. But look what he just wrote about how you sanctify the church. It's not through the organization. He clearly said it's through the Spirit. Because when you say washing of water by the word, you can replace that with through the holy direction of the Holy Spirit. Is that not the same thing? For those who don't have an ear, they're going to argue with that. That's the problem with rule books. It negates this. Yeah, Kody.
Also, you know, marriage is an institution that was established by God. And in these verses, every single time it says, wives, do this as unto the Lord.
Yes.
Husbands, do this like Christ did. It points you back to Christ each time.
Yep.
So essentially, if God is not in the center of your relationship, then you make the other person an idol. Automatically, that's what happens, because you're looking to that other person to fulfill you.
Or
you're making them, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Now, let me ask you this. While Christ is supposed to be the center of the marriage relationship, he's the center of the church relationship. Ephesians 5, we're in. Mr. and Mrs. Tavares, welcome. There's another thing we need to look at, and we need to go a level higher. Jesus said, I always do that which, what? Pleases the Father. Jesus said, I do nothing of my own, or through my own power, but through my Father's power. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments, as I have done what? Kept my Father's commandments. So, while Jesus is the center of the relationship, who are we to honor in our actions? Just as he did. Who? The Father. Because whose commandments are they? They're the Father. I told you, people make an idol out of Jesus Christ, and they put a wedge and an argument between the Father and the Son. Father demands death for violation of the law. Period. We don't like those words. They're hard today, aren't they? They're hateful words, but it's a fact. But Jesus, we can take him and say, no, he did away with all. Really? He killed his own son. He put his own son on the cross for my sins. So we're going to throw that in the pond now. We're going to get rid of that. So then what do we do with judgment and the lake of fire and everything? Silly. So then we go on to say the reason for this, Paul says, that he might present it, the church, that is, to himself, that would be Jesus, a glorious church, not having spot, wrinkle, or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. And folks, that's the way God expects our marriages to be, by the way. Because you'll notice Paul is running the two together. So if there's sacrifice, if Jesus is the center, being a channel to the marriage, to who? Why would he be the center of it? To say we can do what we want, sin as we please, or is he the channel standing before the Father, sanctifying the marriage? You understand? Being led by the Holy Spirit, because it says through the washing of the water and the word, then it is a perfect situation, according to man or God? God. The rest doesn't matter. He recognizes that marriage. Now, question begging to be asked here. If this situation is not in the church, is that church then the bride of Christ. Can't be. Because we just read, Paul said that it has to be without blemish, without spot, and without wrinkle. How can a congregation, Jesus said, I will come quickly and remove your candlestick. Remember? If it is not in harmony with these conditions that are said here, how can it be the bride of Christ? It can't be. So if there's any apostasy, the tiniest bit that is going on in a church, and the people are aware of it, it is the candlestick's been removed. Oh, there's not going to be another chance. Then the people have to make a decision. Because as Rita pointed out, the Laodicean condition is a warning to who? Strengthen that which remains. Does that mean you remain in a church that's in apostasy? Is that what's being said here? Or do you get out? What do you do? Well, if Christ is the center and the Holy Spirit's running everything, you know exactly what to do. Do you not? It's pretty simple. If the church is in open apostasy, the candlestick has been removed. Why do we not believe that? Why do we think it's great stuff to read, but it's simple. If this situation does not exist in the church, I don't care who it is, conference, independent, whatever, it is not a church of God. Oh, it's a church of a God, but not the God. What did Jesus say? One second, Kody. What did Jesus say to the Pharisees in Matthew 23? He called them liars. As your father, the devil, is a liar. And you're just like him. Moses and Abraham, these are not your father. He called them whitewashed sepulchers full of dead bones. Was that his church? No, he'd already told them. Your candlestick's gone. Kody?
The Bible only gives us two or maybe even three, in a way, options for when there's apostasy in the church. There's either, and historically, by the way,
mm-hmm.
either you stand up for truth and you try to do some type of reform, or you leave, or both. Those are your options. Those has always been the historical options and the Bible options.
You can't remain in it.
That's right.
Because what happens, Kody?
Well, you'll get kicked out on your own eventually,
no.
Anyways.
If you remain, you will become part of the apostasy.
You'll compromise.
And
eventually.
I know people, just by walking in the door of that church, you're compromising. When you know that's going on, but then there's no reform going on. And I don't care if it's an independent that's way to the right with all this legalism garbage, that the church is run by how you eat, how you dress, how you relate to a woman. I got news for you. That church is in apostasy too. It's just one ditch or the other. So you've got to make a decision. And you know, I find interestingly enough that as I look through the Bible, God's people were wandering nomads pretty much, weren't they? The faithful ones. They couldn't go to the same church every week, could they? What would happen if they did? Well, Jesus himself couldn't go to the synagogue much because they tried to kill him. So that decision and choice, and if we're walking with Christ, in a marriage, if the husband and wife are bonded together the way they should be, what else do you need? Friends and this and that. It's nice to have them. But when your companion is by your side, what else do you need, really? Think about it. The Lord, it's the same thing with Jesus spiritually. When we are married to him, what else do you need? Look at his, what did Paul say about how they were treated, the apostles? And we don't know the tenth of what. It's not recorded in here. Hunted, he said, starved, naked, treated like wild animals. Isn't that what Paul says? But it's okay, he said. Really doesn't matter, because I'm just passing through. James says we're but a mist that appears for a moment. You see? But this thing of our relationship to the world, you see, that is considered what it says here in Hebrews or in Exodus 20, and verse 14. Exodus 20, verse 14, thou shalt not commit adultery. In light of what we're reading in Ephesians, do you really think that just means a secular couple, okay, knows nothing of God's requirements, how can they commit adultery? How? Well, we've had it drummed in our mind, oh, they can go mess with us. As far as God's concerned, that's a pagan relationship. I know that's hard to believe. But if Christ is not the center of that relationship, it's not a biblical relationship. So how can they commit adultery? Are they keeping the other nine commandments? See the problem? No. If we're not washed with water by the word, okay, not pure, presented without spot, without blemish, you can't commit adultery. Once you understand that, guess what? You can commit adultery. Oh, legally and secularly, yes, you can. But we're talking spiritual here, and we're talking why was this written. Let me tell you what Mrs. White says. That's interesting, because this is her first commentary on this verse. Now, the church uses this to enforce their authority over marriage. Why don't they more worry about their relationship to Jesus Christ instead of what goes on between a couple and their audience? You think that's more important? Because if they focused on Christ and a Christ-centered church, they wouldn't have a lot of relationship problems in their constituency. Does anybody argue with that point or think that's not an it? No. If they were teaching the right thing, the people would be more faithful. That doesn't mean that it's not going to happen, because it does. It's human nature. Look at David. But the point is, what's going on now is anything goes. Even to the point of homosexuality in the church. Do you think that's Christ's bride, really? Because it says Seventh-day Adventist over the door? Do you think so? Really? Let's see what Mrs. White says about that. And you'll notice, as I said, it's the seventh commandment, too. What day is the Sabbath? Seventh day. What's the issue? Who's the great harlot? Now you see, if you go worship in their manner, you're committing what kind of adultery? Isn't that interesting? And that's usually, well, let me read what she says here. All false worship is spiritual adultery. I find it interesting she's not mentioning a marriage between a husband and a wife first, because this goes right along with Ephesians 5, you see. The second precept which forbids false worship is also a commandment to worship God. What does the second commandment say? Well, we can read it. We're here in Exodus. So now she's linking these two together. I am the Lord thy God. I brought you up out of house of bondage. Thou shalt not make any graven images or any likenesses or anything that is in heaven above or that is in earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I am the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and upon the third and fourth generations of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Now, why is Mrs. White connecting the seventh and the second commandment together? Because it's false worship. Who makes graven images, by the way? Not interesting. So right here is talking about the harlot, isn't it? Talking about the whore of Rome. Talking about Jesus Christ could be an idol too, you know, before God. Did you know that? Because if you say, and I've said this, you've heard me say this how many times in the last few weeks, if you say that Jesus did away with God's law and I can sin as I want and go to heaven, you have just made an idol out of Christ and cast God out of your life. Do you see that? It's just like wearing a crucifix. Same thing. saying, kissing it and praying to it and this, that. Same thing. You've made an idol out of Christ. In front of God, and you've broken the second, the seventh, the first commandment. Whose Christ was he? Or is he? God's Christ. Jesus makes that very clear. When he says, I do that which pleases my Father. When he says, I do nothing of my own, but only through him that sent me. When he says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments as I have kept my Father's. So where's the change in commandments there? Where is it? He is saying it's exactly the same thing. So do you see a bit of adultery going on there? If you say Jesus did away with the law of God, is that adultery? He tore up the marriage contract. That's what they're telling you. Which is what? The Ten Commandments. That's the marriage contract. How we relate to God. And he said, what I'm going to do is, the Father said, I'm going to give you help, man, to overcome what's coming on you. In the form of what? A woman. Remember Eve, he gave Adam Eve immediately, right? Just created Eve. Said, here's a woman. When did he create Eve? When Adam realized he needed what? Help. Then he created Eve. You think that's an object lesson? What a couple should be focused on doing? Instead of pulling apart and worrying about what car they're driving, what house they're buying, what school their kids are going to school in, what trend the kids are keeping, what sneakers they're wearing, do you think? Which is more important? So we see that false worship is committing adultery against who? Not just Jesus, who? The Father, all three of them. So a church that is in apostasy is directly breaking which commandment? The seventh. Because if you claim to be the church of Christ, not picking on them, what are you actually saying? What statement, I am the bride of Christ? But if you say the law has been done away with, or if you say, oh, you never overcome sin, you're going to sin right up to the second coming, what are you doing? You're breaking the contract. So then there's no marriage, is there? And if a person who thinks differently but continues to attend that type of an environment, what does God think of them? What do you think he thinks of them? I don't drink. I don't play in bars or anything anymore. But you know what? I'm just going to go sit in a bar and I don't need to drink. Is that okay? What am I lending my self to? What am I doing? I'm endorsing that it's okay to go in a bar. Just because I'm not drinking alcohol, alcohol doesn't sin. Can alcohol sin? Is it possible for a glass of rum to sin? Is it possible for a cigarette or a cigar or to sin? Tobacco doesn't sin. Tobacco used properly can be quite a help to farmers and a few other things. But it doesn't sin. Yeah, Kody?
I just wanted to read something from Revelation 5, chapter 5, verse 12. And they said, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. So those are forms of worship. Mm-hmm. So if you go and sit into a bar, you're worshiping that environment, that lifestyle. That's where you're giving your time. If we focus on where we're giving our money to, our strength, our wisdom, our time, those are all things that are important to us and therefore can become spiritual adultery.
Mm-hmm. That's a fact. That is a fact. Our influence, our just our presence is either saying yay or nay to something, isn't it? Paul said the exact same principle about what? Not eating flesh food. Isn't that what he said? He said, for me, it's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. Remember what he says about eating in a pagan's temple? The meat that's served, it means nothing. If it's clean meat, it doesn't matter. But I won't do it because, you see, the people go in there of weaker faith and they eat this stuff thinking they'll get the power of the deity. And if they see me doing it and thinking they're going to get spiritual gain, then I have blood on my hands. Isn't that what he says? So then why would you go someplace that you know is not doing what God wants to do? Oh, I'm going to change them. No, you're not. They've made their choices. You're going to change, all right. She goes on to say, the second precept, which forbids false worship, is also a commandment to worship God and Him only serve. The Lord is a jealous God. He will not be trifled with. He has spoken concerning the manner in which He should be worshipped. He has a hatred of idolatry, for its influence is corrupting. It debases the mind and leads to sensuality and all kinds of sin. Isn't that interesting? So if the seventh commandment and the second commandment are not being observed, then the marriage is going to be a failure, according to what I just read. Isn't that interesting? That's why it's good to let God pick your partner, by the way. He knows the intents and intentions from beginning to end. So if these principles are not being observed in the marriage relationship, what does God see it as? Adultery. Fornication, which, what does fornicate mean? Fornicate means an illicit relationship. Well, that's a fact about what Mrs. White says here, because Paul said that if it weren't for the law, I would not know sin. That in of itself should make a Christian's hair stand up on the back of their neck. When Paul makes the statement that if it were not for the law, I would not know sin, and then a preacher stands there and says the law has been done away with, what is that preacher saying? There's no way to tell what sin is or is not. So anything goes. Enter in your evolution, folks. Enter in your evolution. Why do you think the devil pushed evolution so hard? Because the truth doesn't matter in evolution. How many decades has it been taught to our kids? The truth doesn't matter. The laws don't matter. You see, when they first introduced it into the school system, it was just going to be taught as what? A theory. And you got to ask yourself, why in a classroom would you not teach truth? Tried and true. Why are you teaching theories? That's religion. What is religion, study and teaching of religion called? What is it called? Theology. So by definition, in that realm, evolution is a theory. It's theology. Why would you be teaching that in the classroom? Why would you give these were evil people that had ulterior motives. Why do we hold up before the world men that we give the Nobel Prize to that say there is no God? Are they ignorant or intelligent, according to the Bible? Actually, they're called fools whose minds have been darkened. So why do we hold these people up as intelligent and really? They're stupid and ignorant and willfully so. So when we've had decades of teaching that you are a monkey or a slime on the bottom of an ocean, it's easy to peddle that the law has been done away with, you see, because the physical laws that God put into effect to create the universe, they're doing away with when they say you've evolved. All that physics and the laws of dynamics, the laws of everything are just wiped out when you teach that. Why would you teach that? because Rome's in charge. And who are they seeking to destroy? You see? So this is a direct result of the teaching of evolution in public schools, and now, I mean, even private schools, that the truth doesn't matter. So it's easy then to teach that the law has been done away with, which the Bible says not. Kody?
And there's also existentialism and postmodernism and all these things. All truth is relative nowadays, and yep. Everybody... There's serious ramifications for this because people don't have... It takes away people's hope from the get-go.
Yep.
If you don't have God in your life and you don't know the word or know the truth, it takes away hope. And that's why we have skyrocketing suicide rates yep. with the young people. I mean, it's just getting worse and worse each year.
Yep.
And that's why we have these, you know, these dumb little catchphrases where we say, if it feels good, do it. Because it's relative. If it's good for you, then that means it's good for you. It doesn't necessarily mean it's good for me, but that doesn't mean you're wrong, and I don't want to offend you. So, and it's just it's a cycle of nonsense.
Yep. Well, it all stems, every bit of it has its roots in the teaching of evolution. Every bit of it. Because, like Rettel says, 2 and 2 do not equal 4 in evolution. It's whatever you want it to be. So, that's true. We hear even with the Bible, well... That's how you read it. It only reads one way, and that's God's way. Period. And as Mrs. White said, God is not trifled with. I think we are the only planet in the universe that doesn't understand that. Even the devil knows that. Because he knows, what does it say? His time is what? He knows he's not going to win. He knows that. But he's going to take as many as he can with through whatever method possible. Now, I'm reading here that the best way to protect against him is through a strong bond of marriage. Isn't that interesting? Secularly and spiritually. Because as we see, as Paul is saying, in the marriage bond, there's the husband, the wife, the Holy Spirit, the Son, and the Father all have to be involved for it to be a real marriage. Whether it's between a man and a woman or between Jesus and the church, which is the same spiritually. If that bond is not there, it is breaking the second and the seventh commandment right off the bat. So how then can it be the bride of Christ? It is not. And there is plenty of discernment in this Bible to tell us whether or not we should be sitting in a bar on Sabbath or sitting in God's house. Because if we're not sitting in a church that is in submission to Christ, you may as well go to the bar. Because it's the same. It's actually worse. Because simply by your presence there, you are condoning and sanctioning what's going on. And I'm so tired of all these Adventists. Well, I'm going to go change them. No, you are not. Today we've got 5,000 people in the back that have an opportunity to make a true change based on the teachings of the Bible. Why would you not be more eager? 5,000, according to demographic studies, actually 15,000 people that have an opportunity to make a decision. Which change do you think Jesus is more interested in? Hardened lawbreakers that are sitting in the pews on a Sabbath, or people that have never heard this message who will take opportunity to? Who do you think Jesus is more interested in? He's interested in all of us. However, your house is left unto you desolate if the church is committing adultery. And it breaks his heart. And it breaks, should upset every one of us in here, the church going the way they are. However, there's a work to do. There's a work to do. Whatever deterred Christ from his path? Even as a child, whatever deterred Christ from his path? Do you know that when Joseph died, Jesus' father, earthly father, Do you know what his brothers did to Jesus? Do you know what they did to him? They badgered him about going to the Pharisees, to submit to the Pharisees, and how wrong he was. And he was creating a lot of problems for them and the mother and the family. Did you know they did that to him? Because Joseph kind of was a buffer there. But when he died, Christ was on his own. He was young. So the excuse, oh, I didn't have all the advantages and opportunities, doesn't wash. Because you see, with God, he levels the playing field, doesn't he? You have more advantages and opportunities than ever. What did Jesus say to the Pharisees? Those who are first shall be last. Meaning, they're not going. Because you need to look up that word. And those who are last shall be first. What was he talking about? The very people that you religious zealots scorn are the ones that are going into heaven. Ahead of you. Oh, they didn't like that when Jesus said that. Because they were the ones that controlled who was and wasn't. Mrs. White has some commentary here that I'd like to read in Ephesians 5. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. It is the purchase of his blood. The divine Son of God is seen walking amidst the seven golden candlesticks. Jesus himself supplies the oil to these burning lamps. He it is that kindles the flame. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. No candlestick, no church shines of itself, for Christ emanates all its light. The church in heaven today is only the complement of the church on earth, but it is higher, grander, perfect. Do you understand that? The same divine, and let me ask you, she said the church in heaven is only the complement of the church on earth. They're identical, except the one in heaven is what? Perfect. What does the one on earth have to become to go to heaven? How can you do that by saying the law has been done away with? It's insanity. It is total insanity. It's gibberish. Just blah, blah, blah. The same divine illumination is continuing through eternal ages. The Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the light thereof. No church can have light if it fails to diffuse the glory it receives from the throne of God. What did she just say? What is synonymous, in by the way, in Hebrew with the word glory? Character. What is she saying? If the church does not reflect the character of God, is it the church? No. Did Jesus preach that the law was done away with? Did Jesus preach that you can sin? Did Jesus preach that homosexuality is okay? Did Jesus preach that if you're making lots of money, God loves you? If you're not, he hates you? You see, Luke 12, folks, is right here. Luke 12. And all this is within Israel, within the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You never hear sermons or people talk about Ephesians 5, do you? Because, you see, the church doesn't like that. Especially the last part of it. Can anybody venture a guess why? What does it do to the church's authority on earth? Really whittles it way down in two areas that they claim to have total authority over. Marriage and salvation. Which are one and the same, by the way. What do I mean by that? We have to be married to Christ to have salvation. And if you're in a marriage relationship on earth, it better be a faithful one, and Christ better be the center of it. You see? And if you're married to a church, it better be centered on who? On God. If it's not, where are you going to go? In that nasty little lake that's going to burn and burn and burn until there's no more sin. It's that simple. The church doesn't like Ephesians, the last few verses of Ephesians. Because, you see, it really, really, quite quickly and simply calls things out to what they really are. And who's in charge, who should be in charge, where our loyalties lie, what our sacrifice is actually the theme of that whole thing, isn't it? Unto the point of shedding your blood. Follow the Lamb wheresoever he goes. She says here, those only who through faith in Christ obey all the commandments will reach the conditions of sinlessness in which Adam lived before his transgression. They testify of their love of Christ by obeying all his precepts. If you love me, you'll what? How many times does a husband say to a wife or a wife say to a husband, if you love me, you'll do this? Isn't that interesting? Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And are they different commandments than the other ones? No, he said, as I have done what? Kept my Father's commandments. Now, how can you possibly say that it's been done away with? He specifies right there in John 15 or 14 or whatever, exactly which commandments. As I have kept my Father. How are you going to twist that? Oh, he didn't mean the Ten Commandments. Really? Well, what other commandments is he talking about? It's so simple and plain. But when your head's been filled with evolution, even in seminary, the truth doesn't matter. And then a person comes to a point, folks, and I'm going to tell you this, where they know evolution doesn't work. They know that. But yet they're going to cling on to it. Why? Because it gives license to them doing whatever they want and it being okay. Because the truth doesn't matter. That's what it teaches. It's theology. It's religious theology. By any definition, by any stretch of the imagination. Because there's no fact behind it. And you have to believe it's a faith-based principle. Whereas the Bible, from cover to cover, is fact. And you can prove it. Out of nature, out of history, out of behavior, it's there. Interesting. So, strengthen that which remains. Keep yourself unsoiled by the world. Increased in goods. Need of nothing. Really? How about a nice, pure marriage? And you know where Paul says, by the washing of water and the word, even in the baptismal ceremony, what are you actually doing? You're dying to the world, to self, and you're married to who? Part of the church in heaven. So, people need to beware what bar they walk into on the Sabbath, or whether they do that or a church. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you, Lord, this Sabbath day. Father, the things that are in your scripture, whip up babes and little children, Father, to learn and to understand, Lord, and to grow up in you, that you are truly our Father, but that we must meet your requirements, Lord, and it must be an individual thing. Be with us, be with those throughout the world, Lord, who are seeking to do your will. Help us to be overcomers and to trust in your Son, your Spirit, and to listen to them. Please be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.